for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while we hear each spoken word, your love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come in teardrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love. Only if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
Our opening hymn is incorrect in the bulletin. It is correct up on the board. It will be number 295. 295.
Thank you.
Eucharist Rite 2 begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer, the red book in the pews. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for a word from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord said, "How great is the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah, and how very grave their sin. I must go down and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry that has come to me, and if not, I will know." So the men turned from there and went towards Sodom, while Abraham remained standing before the Lord. Then Abraham came near and said, "Will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you then sweep away the place and not forgive it for the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous fare as the wicked. Far be that from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just?" And the Lord said, "If I find at Sodom 50 righteous in the city, I will forgive the whole place for their sake." Abraham answered, "Let me take it upon myself to speak to the Lord, I who am but dust and ashes. Suppose 5 of the 50 righteous are lacking. Will you destroy the whole city for lack of 5? And he said, "I will not destroy it if I find 45 there." Again he spoke to him, "Suppose 40 are found there. He answered, "For the sake of 40, I will not do it." Then he said, "Oh, do not let the Lord be angry if I speak. Suppose 30 are found there." He answered, "I will not do it if I find 30 there." He said, "Let me take it upon myself to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 are found there." He answered, "For the sake of 20, I will not destroy it." Then he said, "Oh, do not let the Lord be angry if I speak just once more. Suppose 10 are found there." He answered, "For the sake of 10, I will not destroy it." The word of the Lord.
We will recite the psalm by half verse, breaking at the asterisk. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name. For you have glorified your name.
And your word above all things.
When I called, you answered me. All the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord.
When they have heard the words of your mouth,
they will sing of the ways of the Lord.
That great is the glory of the Lord.
Though the Lord be high, he cares for the lowly.
He receives the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe.
You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand.
The Lord will make good his purpose for me.
O Lord, your love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the universe, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority, by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ. When you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. And when you were dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with his legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public example of them, triumphing over them in it. Therefore, do not let anyone condemn you in the matters of food and drink and of observing festivals, new moons, or Sabbaths. These are only a shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Do not let anyone disqualify you, insisting on self-abasement and worship of angels, dwelling on visions popped up without cause by a human way of thinking, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows with a growth that is from God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus was praying at a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial.' And he said to them, 'Suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him." And he answers from within, "Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything." I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask and it will be given you, search and you will find, knock and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds, and for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. Most of you will recognize those words from Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. In South Louisiana, where I lived for 11 years of my ministry, it is not unusual for people to ask when they meet for the first time, "Who's your mama?" "Are you Catholic?" That's the way they pronounce Catholics. And I think this is the important one, "Can you make a roux?" Well, those are important questions in that part of the world. And what they mean is, where do you come from and to whom do you belong? It's the same all over the country. I probably could have used another region. There are ways of claiming how you belong and of explaining how you act by just saying where you're from. Now, you may be wondering what talking about being part of a particular family in a different part of the country has to do with any of our readings, other than a way to start this sermon. Because I want to focus on the gospel, and I imagine you thinking, not much. if we look at this passage literally, and I do not recommend that, but if we look at this passage literally, we will be tempted to say that it gives us two things. One, the exact words of a prayer to say, and two, advice that all we have to do is pray hard enough and long enough, and we can get God to give us what we want. That is one of the problems with the literal understanding of Scripture, because it can lead to real frustration and heartbreak when we come up against the hard things in life. I asked, but I didn't receive what I wanted. I knocked, but the door wasn't opened. What in the world is this God for? Won't give me what I want. You see, this gospel is not a how-to reading. It isn't intended to give us a recipe of sayings that we can call on whenever we need something or want something. It really asks us to go a lot deeper, to take a look at these verses in the whole understanding of the gospel. And if we do the hard work, we will be rewarded and see that we are getting a lot more than we had thought we should. These verses are part of a whole picture given to us in the gospel, and it is a picture that tells us something very important, what it means to be part of God's family, to be the people of God. Now, if you will recall the last two Sunday's gospels, 2 weeks ago we heard the parable of the Good Samaritan, the story that reminds us that by our actions, our words, the way we treat others is the way in which we understand that we are living in the kingdom of God. We do things in a certain way because we understand the lessons that Jesus taught about how those who claim to be his followers ought to act. And last week, we heard the story of two sisters, Mary and Martha. At first glance, if we take it just literally, it appears that God had a preference for one sister over the other. But actually what he's saying is that we ought to support our actions by prayer. We should constantly renew and strengthen ourselves to do God's will by listening to his word and sharing together in prayer. That is what we are doing here today at its very best. Sharing in prayer, listening to God's word, and sharing the bread and wine. Now in today's gospel, Jesus continues his teaching on what it means to be a disciple. The disciples had heard him teach others. Perhaps they were there when he was with Mary and Martha. And now they want him to teach them to pray so that they can draw closer to him. Well, here's where things get interesting. Our English translation says, "When you pray, say." That is not true to the original Greek text. Rather, it says, "When you pray, you are saying." Let that sink in a bit. It may seem like a distinction without a difference, but it does give us something to think about. Of course, we know that Jesus was speaking to his own people, to the children of Israel. And I think it's an interesting thing. We ought to note that the prayer that we have come to the Lord's, to know as the Lord's Prayer, it's not exclusively a Christian prayer. It's certainly not an individual, you and me, Jesus.
It's a corporate prayer, our Father. When I was at Episcopal High School in Baton Rouge, I said one time to our Jewish students, could you pray the Lord's Prayer? And the group of students I was with that day, they said, well, we could, but we won't, because it's not part of our culture. It's associated with Christianity. But any devout Jew could pray that prayer, and they did pray exactly in this way in Jesus' time. So what Jesus is doing is he is reminding his listeners that they already know how to pray. They had been doing it all their lives. He was making them conscious again of the outline or the form of prayer that maybe they'd forgotten because they were just too familiar with it, or just, you know, saying it by rote or something like that. So Jesus goes ahead and proceeds to give his listeners an example of how prayer ought to affect us. Now, don't make the mistake of turning the story of the neighbor and bread into an allegory. God is not the neighbor, and we are not the folks who need some food in the middle of the night. That is not the point of the story. Rather, the point is, if we are members of God's family, we are bound to act in a certain way. Think of the verses of the hymn that we just sang. The gospel says, ask and it will be given to you. Ask, seek, and you will find. Seek where? Knock and it will be opened. Knock where? I think we just too blithely often say, oh, God is the answer. It'll all work out. That's what happens when we're trying to set things up on a me and Jesus vertical. Just you and me, God, we'll make it somehow. But the demands of the gospel are not vertical. They are horizontal, and further, they are intertwined. It's all mixed up. The implications of this prayer are radical. Imagine if we realize that we all have to be part of this prayer. That if we are part of this family, we need to be the ones who are asked, and we are the ones who sought, the ones who ought to seek out the needy. And we are the ones who must open the doors. This morning's gospel reading, at morning prayer, is from the 25th chapter of Matthew. And as I read it this morning, I thought about Bishop Walter Jones, who ordained me. He often said that this was his favorite section of Scripture, one of his favorites at least. You'll remember it. It's about the sheep and the goats. And Jesus says that, you know, you fed me when I was hungry, you gave me water when I was thirsty, and so forth. And the disciples say, when did you do that, Lord? And Jesus replied, and this was the part that Bishop Walter really liked, when you did it for the least of these, you did it to me. I have said to you before, I hope you recall, this won't be new, that we, when we commit ourselves to the way of Jesus, we are what is sort of technically known as the alter Christus. That is the other Christ. That is Jesus. He is not physically present in this world. He's present through the activity of the Holy Spirit. He is present through the activity of the Holy Spirit working in you and you and me. The only way he can be made known is if we act for him. So imagine, let your imaginations run with it at the very best, if we really opened our hearts and our doors not only to people in need outside the church, but to one another here as well, inside the church. It's going on in some places right at this moment. Receiving the kind of love that Jesus modeled for us, if we can say that this is really who we are, then we are working out the gospel of Jesus Christ in the world. We are the people of God who happen to be Christians, who happen to be Episcopalians, who happen to live in Rapid City, who are members of Emmanuel Church. Welcome to the club. As Bishop Curry says, we are the Jesus people. We are making him present in the world. Thanks be to God. The gospel is doing for us, or it can do for us, what it did for Jesus' hearers. It's reminding us that, yes, this is how we pray. It doesn't need to be anything clever or extraordinary, but we do need to keep our prayer in front of our eyes. We need to remember that it is God who is the Holy One. We need to remember that while he does provide for us, we need to reach out to others and mirror the Father to them. We need to forgive, and we need to be forgiven. We need to remember that no matter how good we are, we still fail, and we are still sinners. But God, who loves, forgives us. For we are his people, and we ought to forgive one another. When we are open to the unconditional forgiveness of him, then we will come to be known as a group of people who welcome the stranger and the sinner. I find it exciting to try and find myself inside the gospel. Have you ever done that? Try and put yourself in the story. We might see ourselves as the Samaritans or the Levites or the priests, what we heard about 2 weeks ago. Or we might identify ourselves as Mary or Martha. But above all else, I pray that each one of us sees ourselves as an integral member of the community of faith. We are the people of prayer living in the kingdom of God. This kingdom, as Jesus constantly taught us, is here. Now, by our baptisms, we have promised to live a different life, the type of life that God would live, the kind of life that God lived in Jesus, a life that looks to the Father through prayer, praying together, reading the scriptures, through our worship, through our sharing of the Eucharist. It's not always easy, but as Paul wrote to the Colossians in the first verse of today's epistle, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. Amen.
Having heard the word of God read and proclaimed, let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 358 of the Book of Common Prayer.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we pray for Christ's church and the world, we use Form 3 of the Prayers of the People, found on page 387.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your words and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Join together in the prayer for the calling of Emmanuel's 11th rector, which is found on the green card in your prayer book. Lord God,
for 132 years, you have blessed Emmanuel, the rectors who have faithfully led your people in the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus Christ. May your Holy Spirit be in counsel as he discerns all the
God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I just want to mention a couple of things that are happening in the next day or two. Tonight is our evening for our once a month meal at Cornerstone Mission. We're still in need of some chocolate milk and some cookies. If you would like to participate by providing those, would be much appreciated. That meal is tonight at 5:30. Tomorrow at noon at Feeding South Dakota, we'll be filling backpacks for children. And if you've not participated in that before, I would encourage you to do so. There's a sign-up sheet out here by the main doors on the tripod. What it amounts to is kind of an assembly line, and we each put an item in the plastic grocery sack. It's not really a backpack, but in the grocery sack, and we pass it on until we get approximately 700 bags filled. During the school year, we do around 1,700. So if you've never done this before and you're not sure it's your thing, come tomorrow and do it when there's not quite as many bags to be packed and see what it's like for you. It's a lot of fun to work together doing that. The other thing I want to mention is that our bishop-elect, Jonathan Fultz, is going to need many clothing items and other items like his crozier, his staff, his bishop's ring, things like that. We're, as a diocese, taking up an offering to help purchase those. I think we all know how expensive items are as soon as they have medical attached to them. The same thing is for the church. As soon as it's a church item, an ecclesial item, the price goes way up. So he needs a lot of different things, a stole, a chasuble, his mitre, his bishop's hat, his pectoral cross, lots of other vestments. He'll be wearing these as he goes around to all the churches in the diocese over the years that he's our bishop. He will also wear them when he goes to national and international meetings as our bishop. So we want them looking good. So as you're able, please contribute to that. There's an envelope in the bulletin today. If you can't do that today, I'm sure that envelope will still be in here next week. Please read the rest of the announcements. There are other important announcements. These are maybe the most urgent. Thank you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, offering and sacrifice to God.
Somebody's down to their last dime. Somebody's running out of time. Not too far from here, somebody's got nowhere else to go. Somebody needs a little hope. Not too far from here. And I may not know their name, but I'm praying just the same that you'll use me, Lord, to wipe away your tears. 'Cause somebody's crying. Not too far from here. Somebody's troubled and confused. Somebody's got nothing left to lose. Not too far from here. Somebody's forgotten how to trust. And somebody's dying for love, not too far from here. It may be a stranger's face, but I'm praying for your grace to move in me and take away the fear. 'Cause somebody's hurting, not too far from here. Down my gun. hard, and I'm opening my heart. Help me speak your love to every needful ear. Somebody's waiting, not too far.
Desires an anointing for birthday, anniversary, travel, illness, please come forward at this time. Let us pray. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel. Surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Brent had to work, so we're doing the anniversary prayer with one half here. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send, therefore, your blessing upon this your servant and Brent, wherever he may be working this morning. They may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and in patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Tell him he's blessed. She prepares to travel, to go to help another. Lord, let her know as she goes that she is your feet, your hands, your eyes, your mouth, your ears, your heart. Let her feel your presence. Let her hear the wisdom of your Holy Spirit, that her work may be effective. And Lord, bless and protect her as she travels. Bring her back safely to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We continue on page 361 of the prayer book. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, the perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, Hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Post-communion prayer can be found on page 365 of the prayer book. 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. One body, because we all share